as Matt might have said. I can't begin to tell you how grateful Jane and I are for the astonishing support that we have had over the past 5 weeks. There are so many of you that I want to thank. You know who you are. From those who found Mattie and did all they could to care for him whilst they summoned help and alerted us to the tragedy. The 10 ambulance personnel who did all they could with 2 doctors to help him. The police and the fire brigade who were summoned because the roof was too slippery for anybody else to go out. Those who drove us to the hospital and home again. The compassionate team at Southampton General Hospital. The astonishing 93 people who were in this church 17 hours later to support us. 2 others went to the church in Switzerland. They were on holiday. Others went to the beach. Their love and support has continued to sustain us ever since, even putting a freezer in our porch, which they've kept full of food, hard as we tried to empty it. And then there's been all the help we've had in the last few days to make this celebration of Matty's life. Thank you. Thank you. Give them all a good round of applause, please. I got through that without my glasses. I didn't mean to. So many of you have written the most wonderful letters and cards. We really, really have appreciated them. But no card was more important to me that was one not to us, but to the newborn sister of Matty's godson. I think it's on the altar, but it reads, "Dear Eva, welcome. I hope you have a wonderful life here on planet Earth." Usually it's great, but every now and again it's really annoying. And then we'll always be here to support you. 3 kisses, Matt. Tragically, that last bit is no longer true. But I do hope that today will go some way in showing that most of the time, Matty's life was great. I think I'll blow my nose. We're hoping that this service will run itself. So will you please stand for the hymns and sit or kneel for everything else. But the service in here is only the first half of the celebration. So when we leave, please make your way reasonably quickly down to the village hall. Equip yourself with some nourishment for the second half, which will start as soon as everybody's there. The plan is, if you need a cup of tea, it's the first door, and if you need something stronger, it's the second. Before that, I have a couple of memories of Matt that I'd like to share with you. You'll see from the wonderful photograph on the back of your service sheet, I can't tell you how proud I am of it, that Matt had lovely, almost white hair. He hated it. He even asked Jane, when he was about five, if he applied black shoe polish, if that would do the trick. And it's the reason he always wore a hat, because from the age of five, he would wear a hat to conceal his locks and called himself Hatterman. Matt loved theatre from an early age, particularly Andrew Lloyd Webber's Jovis, as he called it. So much so, he taught himself to read, listening to the tape, and reading from this, which I was delighted to find earlier in the week. Hugh's holding up a copy of the lyrics of Joseph, for those of you on the radio. So that he was able to spell ochre and technicolour before he could spell mummy and daddy. Looking at the service sheet again, you've seen Andrew Doherty's wonderful map of the area that Matty loves so much and we all hold dear to our hearts. But I feel I need to explain about Chicken Granny. Chicken Granny was Jane's mother. She, as you will have guessed, kept hens. My mother was Duck Granny. She lived but near the old mill in Salisbury, where she loved the children to go and feed the ducks. That's all there is to say about Chicken Granny and Duck Granny at this stage. And finally, during that remarkable gathering, the day after Matty died, Catherine lit three candles. One for Matt, one for us, his family, and one for this church, under whose aegis he will remain forever. We buried him yesterday evening. During the first hymn, the more mobile of Matty's nephews and nieces and I are going to light those candles again. Will you please now stand for the first hymn, and as the line suggests, really give it some welly.
Thank you. And I said to the man who stood at the gate of the year, "Give me a light that I may tread safely into the unknown." And he replied, "Go out into the darkness and put your hand into the hand of God. That shall be to you better than light and safer than a known way." So I went forth, and finding the hand of God, trod gladly into the night. And he led me towards the hills and the breaking of the day in the lone east.
I love the way that Matt's character shines through the service sheet. But I do want to spend a moment on the scandalous accusation. I mean, who doesn't cheat a Monopoly, really? Let me explain a little bit. Many years ago, I was applying for a job at Intel, the large American chip company. And I'd put down two referees, one of whom was Hugh Pelly. And Len, who was Intel's official vetter, gave Wake House a call to find out if Paul was trustworthy. Unfortunately, Hugh was out, and Matt answered the phone. Len said, "Matt, I've only really one question for you, and that is Paul trustworthy?" Matt replied, "No, not really. He cheats at Monopoly." Thanks, Matt. If you look down the hill 50 metres or so, you'll see the family home that we moved into about 35 years ago. About a year after we moved into the village, my parents told us that a new family was coming to the village to live in the house with Mrs. Ferguson, and they had four boys. And I was so excited, and I hoped that we'd become friends. Little did I know that 34 years on, Hugh and Jane would call me their fifth son, and Tom, Dippy, Pids, Claire and Matty would call me their fifth brother. You see, the reason I'm here is because the Pellys have a wonderful way of including people in their lives. And my experience over the years is that they've treated me as family, and none more so than Matt. Being given this opportunity to speak about him is just one more way in which they've treated me as family. And I think my experience is the same as everybody else's, that when you know the whole family, when you know how warm and friendly they are, you've enjoyed the hospitality of the Pelly kitchen, it's no surprise that Matt was as warm and charming and funny and silly and mischievous as he was. During our childhood, we had many good times. Together with our brothers and sisters, we played kick the can and blew stuff up. We played our own very unique game of heads and bodies. We had sleepovers and weed on electric fences. We went on holiday together, played board games until the early hours. We fought and argued, but arguing with Matt was futile because he was very, very good at it. In our teens, Matt and I spent more time together as a pair. And we played tennis together almost every day for two summers. And I remember how Matt decided that a great way for us to revise for our French oral exam would be to play tennis every day, during which we would only be allowed to speak French. He'd go to his bedroom window and point his stereo speakers out the window so we could listen to music, and he'd go and make a jug of gin and tonic so that we could enjoy that as we changed ends. The French improved through the afternoon, the tennis not so much. But that was Matt's way. He just had a wonderful way of making mundane life fun. We went to the Shoe together, the pub, on Friday or Saturday nights and hung out. We hung out in the games room, sometimes for 3 or 4 hours. We'd play pool, throw darts at each other, and absolutely not play on the fruit machine or smoke cigars. Most of the time, we were just being silly. And silliness and mischief was a quality that never left Matty. He'd often say or do something silly, and he'd give you one of his portfolio of looks. He'd give you the Matt Flat smile. Or you might get the shoulder-rising chuckle that also caused him to double over. Or you just get his naughty, mischievous eyes flashing from side to side. And if you ever participated in his silliness, you'd just get one of those looks in response, or you might get a simple Paulus, or Tommy, or your Wally. One of the things I loved most about Matt was his ability to charm anyone. But his charm was never false. and it endeared him to everyone he met. He'd speak to landlords and farmers, to lords, filmmakers, Olympians, convicted murderers, children, and the person speaking to him on the bus in the same charismatic way. And also somehow he'd be able to find ways that he'd, things that he would have in common with people. Maybe it was because he was so gifted. He was musical, an artistic, an actor, a tennis player, a photographer, and a beekeeper who loved nature. Or maybe he was able to connect with people because his mind was so quick and because he was so thoughtful. Kids loved Matty because he could be as silly as a 5-year-old or as cool as a 14-year-old. And adults loved him because he'd ask questions, he'd be empathetic, and he'd show a genuine interest in people's lives. He endeared himself to people in his films because he treated them in the same way, as equals. Many years ago, I remember that Matt was keen to take his belief in equality to the highest authority in the land. Fortunately, Claire, who was about 11, had won a poetry writing competition, and she was going to meet the Queen to collect her prize. Matt instructed Claire to say to Her Majesty, "We are citizens, not subjects." Matt was funny and clever too, and the Pellys have kindly given me access to many of the emails that they've received from people sending their condolences. Funny and intelligent were two of the most common words I came across. Kind was another. Matt chose some different words. In an interview a couple of years ago, he was asked to describe himself in 3 words. He chose love, fear, and apoplexy. It wasn't unusual for Matt to use words that no one else understood. And he had a wonderful way of just making words up that were better than the original. If you found yourself in a ridiculous situation, for Matt that was redunculous. If you played Monopoly, then you'd be playing monotony. And if you landed on Piccadilly, then you'd land on pickle. Never mind. Matt's incredibly fast wit and intelligent humour led him to try improvised stand-up comedy. That's a risk that very few of us would be willing to take. And that was a point made clear to Matt when he was booed off stage in Swindon. I suspect he was too clever for Swindon. Matt was a risk taker. He was an adventurer, and sometimes he could be infuriating because he was so hard to pin down or he'd drop in at the last minute. It wasn't that he didn't care. It was just that his love and kindness were coupled with a great love of adventure. He was a free spirit, and sometimes his independence was costly. But it was that same free spirit and his sense of adventure that meant his life was so rich and so full. Matt used the word fear to describe himself, and I was surprised by that. Because in my mind, Matt was totally fearless. He was a fearless tennis player, a fearless explorer of both the world and also what it means to be human. He was a fearless filmmaker. He rode a motorbike in London and India and down the valley too before he was 16 without a license. But don't tell Jane. He often went kite surfing in Sri Lanka, where of course he charmed everyone, and I understand a tree has been planted for him there. He went parachuting between performances of Julius Caesar, in which he was Brutus. It's not a play that can do without Brutus. When we learned to juggle together, I stuck to regular juggling balls, but Matt had fire clubs and fireballs, and he taught me to fire breathe. And then there was the time that I left my best man speech at home in Bristol, and I needed Matt to come to my rescue. I was in Woburn, where my brother Robert was getting married, and my PowerPoint presentation and my speech were on my laptop in Bristol. So I phoned Matt, who was still there, and asked him to help. He did. Matt left work, he went to my home, climbed up the outside of our apartment block, broke in through a window, grabbed the laptop, and made it out without anybody noticing. He dropped me a text. It read, "Package received, Matt the cat." What a legend, and what a loss too. Some of you will know that Matthew means gift of God, and Matt's name was so fitting because he was a gift to us all, and he was such an incredibly gifted, talented, funny, and personable person. We're so fortunate to have known him, and our lives will be poorer for having lost him. 5 weeks ago at Christmas, we celebrated the time when God sent his greatest gift to the world, his son, Jesus. Jesus lived a life of poverty. He suffered loss and died. Hugh and Jane, Our God knows what it means to lose a son. He knows your loss. Jesus said, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted." It's from the book of Matthew. As news about Matt's death spreads, there will be people all over the world who will feel loss and need comforting in almost every continent on the planet. The breadth and depth of loss is a reflection of just how much and how widely Matt was loved. He was loved by his friends, his colleagues, and of course, most of all, by his family. I had the pleasure of sharing a meal with Hugh and Jane and all the rest of the family a week after Matt died. A meal that was cooked by one of the very many friends who have been supporting them. We laughed and joked and shared stories and cried and watched videos. Hugh, Jane, Claire, Adam, Chris and Tom. That evening was a reminder of what a wonderful and loving family you have. And as you continue to care for one another, and as you bear one another's burdens, as you comfort one another, your love for one another will grow even stronger. And perhaps that is Matt's greatest gift to you. Some of us believe that life itself is a Matthew, a gift of God, that starts now and goes on for eternity. Whatever our belief, let's honour Matt by making an effort to be as charming and as warm and as silly as he was. Let's continue to tell stories about him, about how funny he was, about the way in which he showed kindness to others. Let's re-watch his films, use his expressions, and remember how he made the mundane a delight. And let's take heart that he has left an indelible mark on our lives. Matt, I am proud to have been able to call you my friend and my brother. And I'm not alone here in considering you the funniest, wittiest, and most charming person I've ever known. We'll miss you, Matty.
How to flare your nostrils. How to flare your nostrils to tell your planets from your stars. How to make Tom hop with rage by being able to roll your R's. You should know who the disciples are and the first three men on the moon. Why can't you drop anti-disestablishmentarianism in a sentence yet? You'll be starting school soon. Learn to throw a frisbee. Don't ever listen to Chris. Skipper, a 10-man yacht. Your second serve should never miss. How to charm at barn dances, to dance to the beat. Master of charades, do girls fall at my feet? Speak in fluent French, lead bands as their conductor. Compose on the piano, ski like an instructor. Drums, guitar, trumpet, synth, no point in paying for lessons. Just teach yourself, it's easy. Let's have some jamming sessions. Join a samba band, play at carnival in Rio. master shutter speed and flash, zoom aperture and ISO, motorbikes and kitesurf, get that wind up in your face. Best ways to make you feel mindful as you conquer time and space. First past the post, no confidence votes, Grexit. I'll talk you through the issues of a no-deal Brexit. Direct, produce, act and edit. Catch that sequence with a drone. Make your pal cry with laughter just by how you pick up the phone. Fit your own kitchen. Sketch, paint and decorate. Get deep with ads on history. Cryptic crosswords are easy, mate. That your skill set was unique soon became apparent. I started listening more to the lessons which demanded less of natural talent. Don't date if they're not funny. Don't be spoilt, be humble. Tinder is definitely not as good as Bumble. Speak to the chap in Lidl, he might just change your life. Chat to the lady on the train, could be your future wife. Be thoughtful with your presents, spend big, it's no contest. Curl the ribbons on your gift tags, handmade ones are the best. Buy Lion King theatre tickets for kids you happen to meet. Share a passion for beekeeping with the children on your street. Care and be kind for its own sake, it's genuinely cool. Volunteer with Sophie, inspire the students at her school. Truly listen to people. Find the lessons in their stories. Don't be prejudiced, even if they're Tories. There's a joke in there somewhere. Embrace silly, mad, surreal. Always respect the children. They are the most real. Treasure your friends and they'll look after you. Family is everything. Put them on a pedestal. Take time to get things perfect. A work ethic that's hardcore. Make sure you always have a bag of Maltesers in your mandrel. Make strangers cry with laughter. Always let them in. A front is boring, a waste of time. Get straight to what's within. Be generous in the truest sense. Always buy your sibling supper. Never be too busy for a catch-up and a cuppa.
Let us pray. Bless the creators, O God of creation, who by their gifts make the world a more joyful and beautiful realm. Through their labours they teach us to see more clearly the truth around us. In their inspiration they call forth wonder and awe in our own living. In their hope and vision, they remind us that life is holy. Bless all who create in your image, O God of creation. Pour your spirit upon them that their hearts may sing and their works be fulfilling. Especially we thank you and bless you for Matthew, for all the laughter and beauty he brought to this world. Dear God, you created balance, night to follow the day, the sea to touch the earth, the wonder of the created order, the great variety and diversity of all living things. Thank you that you made us all to be unique and to reflect your love. Draw the Pelly family together in all its wonder and beauty. Help them to love, comfort, and respect each other. Show them how to support and encourage one another. Inspire them to work together to become a picture full of your perfect love as they hold Matthew dear in their hearts, now and forever. And support us, O Lord, all the day long of this troublous life, until the shades lengthen and the evening comes, the busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, Lord, in thy mercy, grant us safe lodging, a holy rest, and peace at the last, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Father God, as we say farewell to Matthew, we entrust him into your care. We pray for happiness and joy to eventually be ahead of us, for wisdom and guidance to be beside us, for grace and truth to surround us, pushing us onwards into your goodness. We know that you will always love and protect us and Matthew, wherever we may be. In the words our Saviour taught us, together we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
As you go, please do fill out the cards that are in the pews, little white cards. Just let us know your name and who has been here. It's a lovely reminder for the family who have been able to attend, because many have travelled from so far and so wide. So please do fill in the little cards. And as you go, may the sun bring you new energy by day. May the moon softly restore you by night. May the rain wash away your worries. May the breeze blow new strength into your being. May you walk through the world and know its beauty all the days of your life. Amen.
Good afternoon. I don't know how many people at the back are still coming in. We'll wait for them. Andrew, how many people behind you? Not many. It is without doubt a wonderful thing to see you all here. And my name's Tom. I'm Matt's elder brother, and with Adam and Chris and Claire, like Matt, I think we all had too much to say, so there's no way that you're going to get away from Pelly children speaking at you today, because we've all got something that we're planning to say that we'd like to say about Matt, and I hope that that will be appropriate. It's hopefully a short tribute, and then after that we're going to recharge our glasses before Cat Reynolds, one of Matt's oldest friends from school, is coming to give you a further tribute. And then we've got Rory Jackson's video, and if you haven't cried at all this afternoon, you certainly will then. I can't watch it, so I will be definitely drinking beer by that point. I am minded to remember my dad's phrase. We always used to tease Dad, standing on the lawn looking out over Ebbesbourne Wake, and looking at this incredible valley and looking at the beautiful church in the distance. And Dad always used to say, "Aren't we lucky?" And so we would all parody him and laugh about saying, "Aren't we lucky?" Every time we stood on that bank looking out over Ebbesbourne, and Matt would be here saying, "Aren't we lucky?" And trying to remember all of that vital, important and special thing that is life and living in Ebbesbourne. And it's difficult, of course, for me to say that out loud, but I hope that you'll know Matt well enough. And of course, you're all here because you know Matt well enough to know that that is what he would be saying to us all. And he would be furious to see anybody crying or not enjoying themselves. In fact, he would be the one standing at the back chatting to his neighbour and telling them jokes about how terrible the speaker was going. And he would be the one who was interrupting, making new friends, having a drink and having a party. And this wake and hopefully memorial is meant to celebrate that. So please make sure that you do that and go and find some new friends, because it is wonderful to see so many people here supporting Matt and our family, as it has been over the last few weeks. I just wanted to start with my first memory of Matt and end with some more recent ones. When I was 8 years old, Mum and Dad went to work in New Zealand and took us on the holiday of a lifetime. My little brother, Matt, and I ran off down the lane overlooking the valley in New Zealand, and we were 20 miles away from the nearest town, and we were on a path high up over the river, looking out over the bush, and the Olympics were just about to start in Los Angeles in 1984, and so when we got round the corner, I decided with Matt that we should start the competition and throw rocks into the valley. But of course, because the Olympics were on, we had to do it discus style. And so I span round and round, having found the smoothest, flattest stone that I could find. I span round and round and hurled it distant into the valley. Of course, when I turned round, I saw my brother clutching his head, blood pouring vivid red on the white sandy path. And my literally first memory of my brother was of his head bleeding because I'd thrown a stone at him. I ran back round the corner to go and get Mum and Dad. And I don't really remember much about it, but I do remember the scar that Matt had forever above his eye. And I always looked at it thinking that was just part of competitive family life. We had had such a happy Christmas, and Matt was an incredible uncle, and it was a lovely, lovely time that we had. And on Boxing Day, we spent several really happy hours street sledging on Henry's new Christmas present down the hill that you walked down from the church down to the village hall, doing 30 miles an hour, lying flat on your back, zooming down the hill, and it was incredible. And Matt, of course, was filming it, because that's what Matt always did. And he was planning with Rosa to do the editing for the film and turn it into this little street sledging video. And he was teaching her about three-point editing, and Rosa and he were really getting engaged with the storytelling and how to do the filming. And it was wonderful watching Matt trying to pass that on. I remember Henry and Matt playing tennis and doing the fortnight loser dance to me and Rosa as we came back from a run together. And I remember him sitting in the dining room with Josephine while she was doing her Christmas Lego. And he had taught her this new laughing game. And it was so perfectly Matt, because the laughing game was the first one to laugh lost. And yet, what you had to do was get all your laughter out. This is what he was teaching her. Get all your laughter out and end up your final laugh with the word ha. And when you had done that, you then had to sit stony-faced before the first person to laugh. And that was Matt's perfect game, because he set you up so completely to fail before you'd even started that it was just a joy to behold, watching Matt and my little Joe laughing their heads off at each other all through Christmas. And Matt was an amazing brother to live with. He was a man who loved the story, loved the narrative. He loved that bigger picture. And he had just bought a book, which arrived the day after he died, on Martin Luther, because he was sure that we needed to be living a better life. And he had, like Luther, his theses that he thought that we all should be aspiring to. And he was trying to challenge all of our family. And I'm sure that anyone that spoke to him would know that he was always seeking the truth. And he was always looking for a better way of doing things. And he was aiming to live a simpler and a cleaner life, one that was much more in touch with nature, much more beautiful, and much less dishonest. And I think that those are values that I will really try to uphold in his memory. Thank you. When I'm just going to finish by saying that we realised that it was going to be really weird passing from me to Adam, and I haven't cried yet. but we thought how appropriate it would be that if you did it in sibling order, that of course there would be Matt in the middle. And when we were talking about that, Dad said, "Well, Adam, I'm afraid you'll always be number three. You won't get a promotion." So here's number three.
Everyone. Thank you, Tommy. As you can see by the amount of us, this might go on a bit. And I'm afraid Matt was the funny one. And I'm going to have to read this, I'm afraid. My earliest memories of Matt are that he was just so incredibly annoying. Not only was he so good at everything, but he was really competitive and taunted me mercilessly when he won. Something's never changed. No one has had quite so much influence on my life, however. He played the drums, so do I. He liked motorbikes, I have a motorbike now. He didn't like milk, so neither did I. I've always been in awe of Matt's creativity, talents and humour, and we were all so proud that he made it to become a wonderful director. His interest in making film all started at age 12, when Dad bought a video camera for our holiday. He soon realised that being behind the camera was the least embarrassing place to be, and I was always thrust up in front. To bring some entertainment to the boring walks in Alaska, sorry, Mum and Dad, we must have been awful. We made films, Challenge Adam Kerr episodes, game shows, nature documentaries, including finding a lesser spotted, purple shiny Y-fronted gormless thig. With Chris hiding in the bushes in his underpants. At home with cousins and friends, we made thrillers, drama and murder mysteries with master sleuth Detective Avery. And despite their limitations, they were all shot with Matt's creative eye and sharp wit and were cut to great music. Ultimately, Matt had even bigger ideas. And what will stay with me above all else is that Matt got to live his dream. We all know that Matt was all about laughter and finding the hilarity in everything. He had a way of making events more fun than they should be and made you feel much funnier than you were. Certainly laughing at other people's expense was not beneath him. Mostly me and Chris. As kids, he would always perfectly mimic those classic expressions of those in strife. Losing 32,000 on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, having a worthless heirloom on Antiques Roadshow, or being the losing nominee at an award ceremony. Matt was able to perfectly capture that gracious smile laced with outright indignation and didn't fate just bite back. Matt was nominated for a TV BAFTA in 2014. When he didn't win, he wasn't even able to put up his loser face into action. Suitably, days before, he got stung by a bee on his face and it had swollen up so badly, he was barely recognisable. To rub salt into the wounds, later that night, he found himself alone on the smoking deck with Naomi Campbell. Matt liked to believe that had his face not been that way, the night would have ended very differently. Matt had mixed success in romance. I remember a time when Sophie and I were living in Australia visiting Matt in Melbourne, and he was trying to woo his mystery new neighbour by rearranging the fruit in the decorative communal fruit bowl into different shapes and patterns. Hearts, question marks, towers. The neighbour responded in kind. This went on for days and obviously reached ridiculous proportions. At one point, he removed all the fruit and just left a pineapple. We learned later that the new neighbour was another lonely chap like him, hoping he'd found the perfect one. But that was Matt all over, always trying to find the fun in everything. But he was so generous and incredibly wise. Matt immersed himself in other people's lives, giving so much of himself. He spent hours with my children. I am so blessed that he will always be a part of them, as he will be with all of you as well. I absolutely idolise this man. I have lost my mentor, my comedian, my inspiration, my tormentor, my moral guide, my confidant, my History Society co-founder, and of course, my dear friend. Thank you.
So I don't know how to follow on from two best men speeches. You know, it feels like this should be Matt's wedding and he'd be so happy to have everyone here today. So thank you. What can I say that's not already been said? I can't say anything. But I do have a couple of things that I do want to just kind of quickly get through. So as a family, we had 10 minutes to speak. I've got a family that likes the sound of their own voices, so I'm left with 30 seconds, which, you know, for son number four is how I've always had it. So it's not exactly a surprise. But I do want to just say that, you know, like everyone, Matt has been central to my whole life. Like everyone in this room, he was not just a brother, but he was a great friend. And to probably more than the three of us, he was also a best friend. And, you know, that's a unique talent that he had, was to kind of get himself infected in everyone else's lives. He made me laugh in every situation. And, you know, during the church service, I think it was really appropriate that so many people were laughing and enjoying themselves. Every time I sat in that church at Christmas, at Easter, Matt and I would sit next to each other or next to one of the other brothers, and we'd try and nail the counter melody. And we try and get it right. And for those of you who sat next to any of us in the church, there's a reason we're segregated, is because myself, I follow Dad's ear for a tune. It's good that Elise and some others have been brought into the family to kind of rectify that. He has certainly helped shape all of us as people, and hopefully for the better, but he certainly has a lot to answer for my sense of humour, my approach to life, and just who, you know, how we kind of take every day and look at the world. I genuinely don't know what my views are on religion or the afterlife, but looking at you all here today, Matt lives on, and Matt lives on in each and every one of us who is here today. So thank you. I know that, you know, I love Matt deeply. We all love Matt deeply. The last month has been very hard, and I know that there's a very long road to come. In one of the amazing letters we've received, someone wrote that grief is just the price we pay for love. We're grieving a lot because we loved a lot. And one thing that is getting us through is the love and support that is in this room and beyond. And it's a testament to Matt that he has so many thoughtful and loving friends. So thank you all. A round of applause for everybody, please. So I just want to quickly finish. Mum is not speaking today, so I just want to say a few thoughts from Mum. She could not have been prouder as Matt as a son, but also as a musician and actor, her filmmaker. She tuned into everything that he made, including Bargain Hunt. And when Mum was told by a school teacher, Barry Perrott, for those of you who went to Bishops, that Mac takes himself seriously, she obviously disagreed with him. Barry went on to qualifying this by saying that Matt was always wanted to do his best, and he always did. He was a perfectionist. But he just managed to do this whilst joking around and messing around and enjoying himself. Matt was uniquely creative in our family, and Mum was particularly proud that the way he forged his way ahead in his career in media which is completely uncharted waters for our family. He ploughed his own path, certainly, and he worked his way up. He's always ploughed that path himself, deliberating at length over picking the right jobs, taking new lessons from each and everything he did. He was thoughtful. He never rushed anything. He actively avoided things that he didn't believe in. He chose programmes that resonated with his values of being loving, caring and honest. The list is too long to thank people today, but she'd specifically like to give a big thank you to the village and community who's rallied around to make today possible. It's not often you can plan a wedding for 500 people in 3 or 4 weeks, so thank you to everybody who's been involved. Most importantly, Mum is thankful for you all being here today and making the effort and braving the weather and just being here to be with us as a family and that support. You know, this is the day that everything begins for us, and that support and that ongoing support is hugely important. So thank you. Finally, just before I pass on to Claire, who's going to read her poem again, I think, we are raising money for charity. We put the Just Giving page up a couple of days ago. For the air ambulance that gave Matt as much support as they could. What they did achieve was they allowed us, along with the first aiders, to all be together as a family when Matt died. So we are raising money. We'd like to raise as much as we can for the air ambulance and also for charity towards young guys wanting to move into the film industry. So any cash donations will go to young filmmakers, and any online donations will go to the air ambulance. So thank you very much.
Hello. Among so many precious conversations this month, four friends really highlighted to me one of the things I love most about Matt. They had all met him for the first time just this last year at Wake House or at dinner in London. And they all described that even before all this happened, they had kept thinking back to that first conversation with Matt. It had had a profound effect on them, and it had really changed their future path in some way. Those who knew him well will know how familiar it was looking over at him, making a new friend and being completely engrossed. Sparking off each other, Matt fueling their excitement to be speaking to someone who found him effervescent, and him being genuinely fascinated about learning about a new patch of the world, or a new narrative, or a new story, or a new perspective that he could really unravel and share with the world somehow. And like clockwork, they would burst into giggles as they realised they both found each other hilarious. Matt didn't bother with small talk. He had absolutely no apology for being exactly who he was. You never felt like he was rushing. He was always up for one more drink, basking in one more story. Being 14 years younger, we could easily not have been close. But with growing up in this family and Matt being who he was, that was never going to happen. Mum has often described Matt coming home from Bishop's and taking off his rucksack, shouting down the corridor, "Where's that girl then?" as he raced down to find me, throwing me up in the air a few times and always having a chat, always having time to have a chat. He was my complete idol as a kid, often taking me on adventures around the valley, driving, hiking, or occasionally on the back of his motorbike. And when he went back to university after the holidays, I would sit on the stairs as he played the piano, usually the Snowman or Chopin, but when I was really in my emo phase, it was particularly helpful when he was playing something that he composed for me, as it was ultimately tragic. Over the last 6 years, I've lived in Brixton and him in Peckham. The first month he moved to London, he had very conveniently just broken up with a girl he'd been really trying to woo. And so he had tickets to Matilda, Radiohead, and our favourite comedian, Ross Noble. So I ended up going with him. And that started an amazing era for us, doing lots of London fun activities, loads of dinner parties and nights out. And most importantly, it kick-started a new nickname for me. Long gone were the days of Clan and the Fema and Mum's standard child. Enter the pension plan. Because I was a student initially, Matt treated me to absolutely everything with a long-term plan that I would, when eventually a successful doctor and he was a struggling director in his later years, I would pay him back with cultural treats whilst we shared our old people's home together. I'm so sad that I won't be able to repay you as we planned, and that I'll have to repay you in other ways. Sorry. And continue doing things that we love doing together. Kite surfing, cycling, comedy, but most importantly, channeling your best Mattisms. Not being afraid to always speak out for what you believe, or even if you don't believe it, just being stubborn and going on anyway. Choosing unbelievable gifts, putting your family and friends on an absolute pedestal and doing anything for them. And as we've mentioned, always finding the fun. The week before Christmas, Matt and I were shopping in Covent Garden, and I had finished after being in a long queue at Mac, the makeup counter, struggling to find the door and being generally in a bad mood. And I saw Matt as if he was pretending that he was coming up an escalator from behind one of the makeup counters with full glittery lipstick and eyeshadow. And that was just, could not be more typical. Matt wasn't perfect. One of his favourite games, Gaps in Claire's Knowledge, was always a steadfast way to get my hackles up. Annoyingly, his passion for literature and politics and history meant that he was fairly difficult to beat. He loved sharing a fact, and irritatingly, his curiosity was so infectious that you didn't have to spend long with him before you'd find yourself looking for new creative ideas everywhere. I was in Jerusalem a few years ago and chatting to Matt on FaceTime about the contents of my walking tour that day and the fact that he just had to come and had to visit it and had to make a film about it. And by the time I'd finished that particular story, he had already bought plane tickets and was on his way. Similarly, on Christmas Eve this year, 2018, we were making mince pies together whilst I regaled the horror stories of being a junior doctor in Woolwich. When I turned around to see that he had stopped rolling pastry and had already drafted a letter to the hospital chief executive to ask if he could come and shadow me at work. Trying to summarise Matt in words is like the most impossible thing, but it means so much to have so many people here who understand that and also understand the pain that we won't be making any more memories together. Matt adored our parents, his siblings and his friends, and he loved a party, loved a family gathering. And it's unbearable that he's not here to enjoy us being so nice about him. Matt's given me positive direction my entire life. He truly listened, he opened his heart, was proud, made me feel hilarious, and teased me horrifically. When I think for a second that he had that impact on so many other people here throughout his life, then I just feel so lucky to have him. I've had him as a brother. Life is going to be a lot harder, a lot less surprising, and less full of unique kernels of joy. But we will work hard to channel your glorious creativity, generosity, and magic.
So I'm going to do round two now, round two or four, I think. So we'll cycle through until we've got to the bitter end. I am so grateful on behalf of the families for everyone being here, and thank you so much. Please can you look at the photographs at the back, look at the photographs on the side, read the letters in the distance, write a letter on the memory tree. So many people have been so thoughtful about trying to make sure that Matt is being remembered in the right way, and I am so proud of how this place looks, and mainly thank you to my lovely wife and family for supporting me in this, because it has been incredibly difficult. Please, could you go to the back and get a beer? Go to the cup of tea stand and get a cup of tea. Please, could you come back in maybe 5 minutes? Is that too little time? Almost certainly. But Dad's saying 10. Come back in 5 or 10 minutes for the last bit of formal tribute, which will be Cat Reynolds and then Rory's video. So go and charge your glasses, because I'm sure you're bored of standing up. Go and have a little walk around. Come kindly back in for the last little bit, which will be by no means the least. So thank you so much.
And it's a real honour to be asked to say a few words, but now I just realise I'm saying the same thing that everyone else has said, but with words in a slightly different order. And the family said, "Don't worry, Kat, don't change a thing." So I really did struggle to know what to say, because partly because I'm still reeling, as I'm sure everyone is, and partly because I think Matt could be 100 and we'd all still feel that there were more good times to be had with him. Matt would say that a good friend is someone who knows you inside out and loves you anyway. And it's not surprising that perhaps we all use the same words to describe him, though he's funny, kind, talented, intelligent, I would add occasionally stubborn, because he was so authentic. I think it's so rare to know someone who's just so honest, so comfortable in his own skin. And he would deliver his Mattisms, as Claire calls them, you know, in his Timberland hat with his sitting in his family battered old armchair, drinking wine from a tumbler, and it had to be European wine because you've got to watch your carbon footprints, and a tumbler just because he likes drinking it out of a tumbler. Or he'd be on his endlessly pimped up Claude Butler bike or in a string of VW Golfs that he gradually run into the ground. And, you know, he'd gallantly pick me up in it, and I'd be busy clearing like a mound of rubbish like from the passenger seat, and he'd jokingly drive off when you still had one foot on the pavement. And that joke never got old. Or your favourite, he'd be wearing that suit that I think we have Hugh to thank for, twinned with a blue frilly shirt, endlessly spun to meet every fancy dress brief while he spun some beautiful woman around a dance floor, and somehow that worked for him. But for me, from the moment he picked up the phone with a, oh, hey, or BAFTA-nominated Matthew Pelly speaking, or my favourite, welcome. That's what it felt like, welcome. Welcome to the magical world of Matt, because, you know, as you open the door to him, he'd be standing on your doorstep, and you'd get a welcome. And only Matt could riff off an entire phone call with, what you do? This would be me. What you do? No, what you do? What you do? And it would on and on. And then he'd just hang up, as he'd do sometimes with Chris. Only Matt could slide you to the edge of a cliff to avoid an oncoming truck. And then sort of dust himself down. You all right, Ronaldo? Good. Get back on the moped or we're going to miss the elephant sanctuary. Or only Matt could gate crash some private media party absolutely covered in mud. Only Matthew Pelly could hitch a lift with Matthew Kelly and then have exchanged numbers with him by the end of the journey. And it's something that I will miss most about Matt, that he made anything seem possible. He was always lifting you up to see what he was trying to see, encouraging you to take risks and to dare to fail. And things that I might find deeply embarrassing, Matt would laugh at himself. You know the BAFTA red carpet story. But also he would just, you know, he'd enjoy the fact that he could only really muster a ginger neck beard for many years. Or would turn up to a first date wearing mismatched trainers. And the list goes on. But I also love Matt's boundless creativity, how he lived in the present with one eye on the future and endlessly found meaning and purpose in life. And it gave him a real vocation. And write about what makes you angry and put it right, he'd say. Or having a camera in my hand is just a great excuse to talk to people. And he had this incredible drive that just came from a love and a fascination with humanity and what it is to be human. And I love how Rory, who's put the film together with him, described working with him, like how their contributors would sort of button themselves up, ready to talk to the very important, very clever filmmakers, ready to interview them about their lives, and these two idiots show up. He just had this kind of compassion and absolute sense of fun that would just could get the best out of any of us. All the worst. Like in a King Lear rehearsal at school, he's Lear, I'm Regan, it's their big angry shouty showdown and one of us fluffed a line, whatever. But then Matt gave me this funny look of, and from there on in, I just couldn't stop laughing. In other words, we just couldn't get through the scene. And much to the frustration of John Cox's English teacher, who was directing us at the time, who is here, I think he had to send us out of the room, still laughing. And we were told to sort of grow up and calm down. And 10 minutes later, we were fetched back in, still laughing. And I think I was sent home, still laughing. Well, Matt worked on a monologue. But then in performance, he absolutely nailed it. As one reviewer said, Salisbury Journal school section, Matthew Pelly made Lear's senility and empty threats comical and yet pitiful and deeply moving. And that was Matt. Even age 17, even as a schoolboy, he had the ability to read the truth of the moment, from the sublime to the ridiculous. And, you know, as everyone said, he didn't have to know Matt decades to have made a profound connection with him. And I think the number of people here today would blow his mind. But the thing that would have mattered to him above all else is his individual relationship with you. Only connect, he told me, was his favourite sort of quote from E.M. Forster, which meant to value human relationships above all else. And he'd always, as you've been saying, he'd be telling the people that he loved about the brilliant new people he met, like, only connect. And he was pretty discerning. He would puncture idiots. He would, you know, he would put people straight if they were ever being mean or unkind. So the person standing next to you is probably pretty brilliant. And they probably need a giant Pelly sideways hug. It was a bit like this. I know, Ronaldo, I know. But as Paul said in his beautiful eulogy, they will definitely have their own wonderful stories about Matt to share with you. Only connect. And so I haven't even begun to see how the future's going to be as bright or as kind of confident without Matt. I don't feel I'm going to love that hard with anyone else. But, you know, Jane, Hugh, you are made of special stuff to have raised five such awesome human beings. And the Pelly qualities are onto all of you like an absolute stick of rock. And we are here for all of you in the years to come. However you want us, I know we've been inundating you recently, however you want us to keep Matt's memory alive, we all need to too. And because the only thing I do know is that it can't be the end of Matt's story. He was all about beginnings and starting something good. With our mate Vic, we shipped an entire library of children's books out to India because we were at an orphanage and he wanted to do something, anything, to further his granny's legacy there. And what a legacy he leaves us. To be inspired, to be ourselves, to say yes, to be open to people, to see potential, to seek the truth, think big and don't sweat the small stuff. Just be silly, be infinitely silly. And when you think you haven't been silly enough, just keep being silly. And he was such a kaleidoscope of a man. And if I close my eyes, he's still so vitally there. Matt, Matty, Matoir, Pelloir, Matthew Pelly off the telly, Pelly Dog, Pellinator, Matthew David Pelly speaking. And whilst he belonged entirely to himself, I think I'm right in saying that we're all so lucky that we got to feel that he was our Matt Pelly. And thank you, Matt.
Well, if I wasn't crying before, and the answer is I am, I don't know, I haven't seen Rory. Where is Rory? Rory, do you want to come and say anything? You don't have to. I'll do it from here. Rory Jackson has amazingly, wonderfully done some video, because one of the things that we knew that needed to happen today was to have some film, because Matt was always about the film and it was always about that. And I, in our family, we knew that we could do the photos, we knew that we could do the feeling of this whole thing, but what we couldn't do was the video. And how do you do a video to somebody in 4 weeks? And I thought it was impossible, but we knew it had to be done. And Rory has stepped up to the plate, and it would be great if you wanted to come and say a few words about that. And we're incredibly grateful for everybody's contributions, because it's been immense, and for your help and support with doing that, Rory.
I obviously won't keep you long. Hopefully the video speaks for itself. It's got very little to do with me and a lot to do with everybody who sent through photos and videos. I think there was close to 1,000 images and pictures and videos that were sent through. Matt once said to me when we were working on The Complainers, which is where I met him, that he felt we were so lucky to have a craft that meant that we left something behind. And that didn't really chime with me at the time, because we were making something about customer services. um, But when I watched what we'd made together, I realised that it was about the human stories, and I hope that I take that with me in my career and the things that he's taught me. And I think it's testament to how much of an interested and wonderful person he was. So thank you.
Acted as a kid, but I was always making films. I realised the things that were moving me emotionally and were observational films, and actually stories are stories, and documentaries are stories just like anything else.
We have got so much food and beer and wine, and we would love you all to stay, and we will probably play the video again. It would be nice to do that. Thank you, Rory, so much. I know Channel 4 paid for editors. There have been such an outpouring of love within the industry that has been mind-blowing to us as a family who didn't really understand about that side of his life, and it's been wonderful. Please go and read the letters, take your time, and please stay. That's what we really want, is for you to be here. Memory tree, all those things. Thank you so much.